This video is all about our invisible friend, carbon dioxide. It's one of those lovely little gases that ends up dissolved in our water columns and is really quite important for all of the plants that are growing in our aquariums. So if you want to have great growth of your plants, guess what? Carbon is the thing that lends the mass to the plants. You could break it down by the molecule. Kind of crazy, right? It's not the water, not the nutrients, it's the gas. For the first half of our experiment, we decided to test soil and sand versus just sand to see how much CO2 it would give off. Just a regular mix here, and the sand is just your run-of-the-mill pool filter sand. Great stuff, use it in all my aquariums. We have a CO2 gas probe from Vernier, and I set up these arrangements right here because it cannot be in a humid environment, so I needed to capture the gas in a separate chamber. Started off by adding a layer of soil, as we always do, throw some pool filter sand right on top, and then let the magic happen. And speaking of the magic is basically going to be decomposition. It's going to be respiration. Every little thing that is alive in your tank produces CO2. And all of that CO2 has got to come from somewhere, right? Some kind of energy source. Majority of it is going to be coming from your plants and stuff, or plant material that was once alive. So in the case of our soil here, you can notice that there is lots of plant fibers in there. And so there's going to be lots of microbes, fungi, bacteria, you name it. They're all going to be in there breaking it down, either through decomposition or cellular respiration, and release CO2. The sand flask is set up with the exact same source of pool filter sand, but no soil. For the water source, I wanted to get something that I knew had microbes and stuff already ready to go. That way there wouldn't be any weird things going on as far as waiting for bacterial levels to increase, or there being the fact that the soil would bring in more microbes than just the sand by itself. So I went with the aquarium water that I already have, which I know has life in it, and added it to both of these containers. As for a little background, you're going to note that when you are having a soiled aquarium, one that has dirt in the bottom, you're going to find a lot more growth in the beginning of your aquarium simply because all of these readily available organic pieces of matter down in the soil system will be broken down the fastest, and then the ones that are thicker with more volume as opposed to surface area, those ones are going to be the ones that will steadily supply CO2 throughout the life of your dirted or soiled tank. So our first results come in after 12 days, just an arbitrary period. It's what worked with my work week the first time, so I kept going with it. Did a regular burn-in with the sensor, comes in at 200 parts per million in the regular room, and then it's time to insert it into the bottles. First up, we have the sand only. The sand only did end up producing some CO2. As you can see, it's about 1,000 or so parts per million greater than just the room parts per million. And after that, we went and we sealed it all right back up again. And the hope here was that we would see some sort of change based on refreshing the system with a little bit more oxygen so that those organisms that are doing respiration would be able to continue on their process, because respiration is the key thing that a lot of these guys are doing to release CO2 when they're alive. And then we insert it into the soil. And soil, wow, look at that. We're getting about twice as much as just the sand alone. Here's all of those together so you can see. And then, just like the sand one, we're going to bottle this one back up for a few more days and see what happens to our CO2 levels. And we'll come back and look at it over 16 days. Here we go with another burn-in on day 16. And let's take a look. Did these things change? Did they stay the same? Make your bets now down in the comment section. What do you think? Did the sand stay the same? Did the soil one go up? Did it go down? What happened? And did you do it? Here's the results. So sand stayed about the same. If you recall, the last one was about 1200 as well. And then we get to our soil one. Soil one, pretty some interesting results. Oh, there it is. It's in. And here's your results. So wow, look at that. We're up to 4200, almost 4300. Wow, it increased. And again, somewhat predictable, because we added a little more oxygen to the system. So after running the initial experiment with just sand and soil, I got to thinking, like, hey, I want to find out how much does leaf litter throw in there? How much would be taken out, or would there be a balance or something if we had plants? So again, we just reloaded the deal. Don't worry, I took the endlers out. And so we again started with some aquarium water, which you can see is a lovely tint. And we insert the alder leaf, and we insert a piece of Elodia, an aquarius. Geez, I always get it mixed up. Who knows? So we put those in, hook them up to our same little bottles there, where we're going to capture just hopefully the gas over on the plastic bottle side, and not so much of the humidity, because again, the sensor can't hold up to humidity, which is also why I don't have long-term data for you. I couldn't leave the sensor in there. It would get damaged over time. Also something to note, the long-term data would give us a wonderful view of the flux that happens throughout the day in CO2. It's too bad we couldn't get it. Here we are, after 12 days. Yes, I picked 12 again to keep it even with the other one. We have our alder leaf, we have our Elodia right here, and it's time to pop in the probe. First up, we get our baseline. The room CO2 is 358 parts per million. And up first is the one you're probably all excited about, the leaf. Shove that probe in there, get it fired up, and voila, wow, 21,374 parts per million. That's a whole lot more than the soil. The big thing here is that that leaf has a lot more surface area, and it's also not being smothered by a whole bunch of sand. Here's our plant one. Our plant one did an interesting little deal here and eventually settled out at 1300 parts per million. Time to see what happens on day 16 now. We're going to take again a look at our alder leaf and a look at our Elodia slash Anacris. Get our baseline first. Baseline today is 375 parts per million in the room. And let's go ahead and pop open our leaf one, because that's what everybody's waiting for. Did it go up? Did it go down? Did it stay the same? 3, 2, 1, data. Wow, look at that. It's still increased. Pretty predictable, of course, as long as there's still matter to be broken down, whether it be something doing respiration or decomposition, you will still get CO2. So let's go ahead and transfer this over to our plant and see what happens here. There we are, all of the three on 16, and then let's compare that to our 12 day. So doing the math on all of this and looking at research papers, you're not going to get CO2 to the levels of some of these high-tech tanks through soil supplements, the soil itself, leaves, all of that. They're not going to get you to that high-tech aquarium, but they will supply CO2, and CO2 is absolutely essential for this plant life to happen. And the supplements that we add to the soil are great sources of long-term CO2. So it will get you beyond just your typical potting soil, garden soil, compost, whatever it is that you're using, and it will make sure that you will have a CO2 supply for the months after you set up your aquarium and all the plants grow in. I hope you enjoyed this lovely little look into carbon dioxide in your aquarium. And if you happen to like it, well, smash that like. Don't forget to leave us a comment. And do subscribe for more wonderful natural aquarium content right here on Father Fish. I'll see you next time. This has been Ryan. Good night.